Welcome to the fourth edition of our UpLoad video magazine in 2023. Today, we start in the Balearic Islands, where we'll take a look at a job that requires plenty of finesse. Heading across Europe, our journey then continues to Great Britain, where LTR cranes are proving extremely popular on numerous construction sites. And if you're curious about what this particular system entails, we'll cover this in our third article. It's still quiet in the harbor of Palma de Mallorca when the tailboard of the ferry jetty opens and a blue LTM 1650-8.1 owned by the crane rental company Le Mans rolls off the deck. Its mission is to dismantle the 72-meter-long, 24-ton aluminum rig of a superyacht. The challenge here is to avoid causing any damage to this extremely fragile load. Ahead for heights, sure instincts and technical know-how are required whenever the mast of a small sailing boat or a superyacht needs to be serviced. As specialists, riggers are also responsible for the construction, erection and tensioning of sail masts. And the taller the mast is, the bigger the crane that lifts it off the boat needs to be. One company that handles this kind of rigging work is RSB Rigging Solutions in Mallorca, which arranged for a crane to be specially shipped in from the Spanish mainland to Mallorca to work on a superyacht. Many hours of planning and preparation were necessary for this harbor operation. Six riggers from RSB Rigging Solutions spent about 10 days just preparing the rigging for the lift. Once the mast is hooked and lifted out of its anchorage, it's important to pay attention to the wind conditions.
It's an unstable rig when it's jacked down and hanging underneath the crane, so we have to be very careful with the way it's managed as it's lifted out of the boat. It's going to be lifted with the big crane here and then swung over onto the hard area here. And then we hook in a second 200-ton crane into the bottom, put it horizontal, and then drop it down onto the ground.
The second crane RSB Rigging Solutions used on this project was also a Liebherr crane, an LTM 1200-5.1 from the Mallorcan transport service provider Grúas Pol's own fleet.
Specifically for this maneuver, we have encountered a problem that the crane with 300 tons capacity that we have at the moment is not capable to perform its operation. So we had to subcontract a crane from Lehman, who is our long-standing partner, and they were able to lend us a 650-ton crane so that together we were able to carry out this operation.
Once the mast has been placed on the transport trestles and driven into the shipyard hall, it's ready for maintenance. This takes about 12 to 18 weeks for a sailing rig of this size. Did you know that we've been manufacturing crawler cranes with telescopic booms in Ehingen for almost 20 years? In the early days, this crane type was overshadowed by our traditional mobile and crawler cranes. But since then, the popularity of these highly flexible and compact LTR cranes has increased enormously. This is confirmed by a look at the British capital, whether in London's Canary Wharf business district, the construction sites for HS2, the UK's largest rail infrastructure project, or a residential development in Greater London, LTR cranes are in constant use on major British projects. A fashionable shopping and residential area is currently being built in London's Docklands. Since they're also mobile when under load, Liebherr telescopic and crawler cranes are not only in high demand on this construction site, just outside the city in Leatherhead, two LTR 1060s are also working to build a multi-story residential building. The two cranes from Q Crane and Plant Hire have taken over all the jobs usually performed by standard construction cranes, and are also helping to operate the materials store, offload the delivered construction materials from trucks, and transport them to where they're needed.
We've got a lot of pick and carry duties due to the length of the site. At the beginning of the site, we had to track even 100, 200 meters from one end to the other. Now it's 10 meters or so, as you saw earlier on.
We're building 214 flats on four stories here. Normally, two or three tower cranes would be used for this kind of project.
We have the crawler cranes here instead of the tower cranes, just because of access and movability of surround site, so we can move materials. And also, if we didn't have the two crawler cranes, we probably would have to have more cranes as well, tower cranes. Obviously, that might take up more space and obviously might be more time consuming to build and erect and take down.
It's an exciting development that these machines are now so popular that they're also being used on the numerous construction sites for the high-speed 2 rail link project. The line is due to be completed by the end of the decade and will almost halve the journey time from London to Birmingham. Trains that can reach speeds of 225 miles per hour are required for this, as are new efficient routes, junctions and stations in the metropolis's underground. For 6 years, what will become the biggest railway station in Great Britain, Old Oak Common, has been under construction. The site stretches well over a kilometre in length and includes 14 above-ground and underground platforms that will handle 250,000 passengers every day. An especially practical feature on this construction site, where space can sometimes be tight, is the ability to adjust the travel gear to a narrow position. With a width of only 3.5 metres, that is 155 centimetres slimmer, the crane can easily roll on to the next job. In every respect, the workers here appreciate the flexibility of the LTR cranes. Another hotspot for the high-speed rail project is located near Uxbridge on the western edge of London. The Copthall Tunnel is being built here using the cut-and-cover method over a distance of 880 metres. A lone LTR 1060 handles all incoming construction materials. An LTR 1040 and an LTR 1220 are directly involved in the tunnel construction. The reinforcement work is scheduled for completion in 2025. According to predictions, the first trains are due to travel through the Copthall Tunnel and enter Old Oak Common Railway Station in roughly 10 years' time. Our third topic in this issue of UpLoad is the energy transition. Climate protection is on everyone's lips, and it's about more than just the CO2 emissions from machines. I'd now like to talk to three experts from Liebherr about this. And up first is fleet manager Bertolt Ströbele. Hello, Bertolt.
Hi, Martin.
Bertolt, the fact that cranes from Ehingen can now be refueled entirely with HVO is no longer news, but alternative drive solutions are playing a major role not only in large cranes, but also in mobility management. How does this affect the fleet?
So we are just starting to expand our electrically powered vehicles. We've carried out a fleet analysis and checked the range and type of use of the pool vehicles, and we now have 17 electrically powered vehicles in our vehicle pool.
In particular, a steadily growing workforce poses major challenges for mobility management. What's the current situation at the Ehingen plant?
So the rapidly increasing number of employees presents us with huge challenges, especially in terms of parking management. Currently, we can't offer every employee a parking space. We've now drawn up a mobility management concept. This actually involves sustainable solutions to enable employees to get here to their workplace from home without having to use their own car. For example, there is the topic of a staff shuttle. We call this the Mobility Plus shuttle. We've now entered the test phase and are attempting to bring 340 employees from Ehingen within a radius of 1 kilometer from the bus stop to the factory twice an hour. The advantage for the employees in this case is relatively simple. They can travel to the factory faster because the bus goes directly to the factory and the bus stop is right in front of their workplace. So they don't need to walk all the way here from the car park to reach their workplace. The bus has a special driving permit so it can bypass the Liebherr traffic jam in the morning. That saves us at least 10 minutes. Another benefit for the employees is that the bus is free and it runs twice an hour. These are some initial ideas that we're thinking about and implementing.
Fantastic. So a lot is happening in mobility management. Thank you, Bertolt.
Thank you, Martin.
Mobility management is only one aspect of the energy transition and climate protection. This topic also encompasses entire industrial processes and energy-efficient building renovation. I'm now joined by two more experts in this field, Christian Wolfle from Industrial Services Electrical and Jürgen Abele, Division Manager for Industrial Services and Construction. Hello, you two.
Hi, Martin.
Jürgen, what does the energy transition and climate protection mean for the Ehingen plant?
It's a very exciting subject because the topics of climate protection and environmental protection are also very much in the minds of the wider population at the moment, who are asking themselves, what can we do? And we've been doing the same for decades. For example, what can we do to exploit renewable energy sources? Take the example of photovoltaics, which we want to expand to 2.8 megawatts on this site this year, and there are even discussions about expanding this even further. Another exciting aspect is the draft legislation, which is constantly changing. This adds quite a bit of confusion to the equation here, and it's also very difficult to deal with these issues in a way that improves our efficiency. However, we've been independently working on the issue of energy and climate for years. What positive steps can we take? Another exciting development in this context is our plant expansion on the Berg industrial estate, which is currently underway. We'll also try to implement climate and environmental protection initiatives there.
We're talking energy concepts here, especially in relation to the heat supply.
Yes, the heat supply. Everyone thinks it's very important for us. The halls and the offices must always be evenly and permanently warmed to create our so-called feel-good climate. But this isn't our focus. We're asking ourselves, how can we use heat sources, optimize them and improve them? And this includes, for example, geothermal systems, heat pumps, exhaust air heat from extraction systems, or even heat recovery from compressor systems. These are topics that we also want to address and develop further. And I think we're on the right track. But as I said, the state of the art is evolving, and it's exciting to see what the future holds.
Christian, you work as a building control technician here in Ehingen, so you have an overview of all our energy consumption.
We can control each building via our building management system. Using a central system, we can control not only the heating, but also the lighting, skylights, compressors, extraction systems, and even the refrigerators in our medical facility and in the canteen.
Thank you both for these exciting insights, and many thanks again to Bertolt Ströbele. Liebherr began developing building management systems in Ehingen more than 20 years ago, so all of this has not happened overnight. The latest technologies and our in-house development of control technology have consistently been incorporated. Depending on the amount of daylight, we can reduce our energy usage by a further 30% through the use of LED lighting. We're taking a holistic approach to the energy transition in Ehingen, from each individual employee to the final product that ends up being used on gigantic projects such as the Baltic Eagle Wind Farm, with its green electricity. And that's it for today. I'm already looking forward to the next issue, in which we'll take a look at the latest incarnation of our telescopic crawler crane, among other things. See you soon!